please be seated. Let's share together the call to worship. We have come to worship as people who have longed for a better future. We have dreamed of a time when those who are hungry are fed, and those who are lonely have a friend. Those who feel sad laugh and sing for joy. We have gathered to get together, trusting in the promise of new life, that each one of us is called by name and cherished by the divine. Let us give great thanks for the promise of this new year. God of the manger, we put our trust in you. And we will sing together our hymn number 160 in the Book of Praise, "Unto Us a Child is Born."
Share a warm welcome with all of you. We give thanks to gather in person here at Knox Sanctuary, and Happy New Year to everyone. We are grateful for worship with those who are listening on the radio, FM 98.5, those who are live streaming, and those who will watch us later on YouTube. We begin the year 2023 in the peaceful activity of praying, singing, and reflecting on the good news of the birth of the Christ child. I'm happy to be leading worship today with Mark Getke. This is our third year in a row of doing it on the Sunday after Christmas, so this is becoming, a bit of a pattern, a good pattern. So one of our church's ministers in association, Mary Catherine Pisano, is our music director, and my name is Deb Schlichter. I'm the clerk of session here at Knox. Thanks to our tech team who are with us today. We've got Grant Burks, Mark Culp, and Kathleen Ford. So thanks again for all your work behind the scenes. Today there is no Sunday school for children. So just to let you know, I see some children here. They are invited to stay in worship, or they can go out and stay in one of the rooms if you're needing to do that. But Sunday school will start again next Sunday. We acknowledge that Knox Waterloo is located on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and Neutrals peoples. We seek a renewed relationship with our neighbors, one that is based on honor and deep respect. We give thanks for the ability to gather, work, and worship here. Let us join together in prayer. Shepherd of the stars, We give thanks for this Christmas season that extends right into the opening days of this new year. We treasure all those who are part of our community, from the oldest to the youngest, and all those in between. We ask that we may be part of your nurturing love for each and everyone. Take away our cynicism and temptation to roll our eyes and say something mean. Grant us the wisdom to hold our tongue when a hurtful word comes into our mind. May we learn from the birth of the Christ child to see the sacred in the ordinary and to speak words that give hope to the vulnerable and those who are afraid. Inspire us to be childlike in our curiosity, our wonder, and our welcome to those who long for a safe harbor. Day by day, may we see you more clearly, love you more dearly, follow you more nearly. This morning, we put our trust in your welcoming spirit and in one another. Amen. We now join together singing the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
in Christ, you are a new creation. The old life has gone, and a new life has begun. So, friends, believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And the peace of Christ be with you. As it fits for you, just turn to one another and share a greeting of peace at this time. Peace be with you. I see two folks there. You can just stay where you're seated right now for what we're doing, if you'd like. Is that a good fit? Stay with Mom. This morning, I would like to tell all of you a story by Robert Munch called Love You Forever. Now, in the center of the story is a song. And on his website, Robert Munch tells his readers that they're welcome to make up the song as it fits for them. For me, this opportunity for creativity invites us to not be bound to a single way of sharing our love. There are as many different tunes to sing as there are grains of sand on a beach or stars in the heavens above. Nevertheless, I like Robert Munch's tune that he delivers for the song, and that's the one that I'm going to share with you as I tell the story today. Now, there once was a mother who had a little baby in her arms, and she rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And as she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, that baby grew. He grew and he grew and he grew until he was 2 years old. And he ran all around the house, and he pulled all the books off the bookshelves, and he pulled all the food out of the refrigerator, and once he took his mother's watch and flushed it down the toilet. Sometimes that mother would say, this kid is driving me crazy. But at nighttime, when that little boy was asleep, she would open up the door to his room, crawl across the floor, and look up over the side of the bed. And if that little boy was really asleep, she would pick him up and rock him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And as she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, the two-year-old grew. He grew and he grew until he was 9 years old. And he never wanted to come in for dinner, and he never wanted to take a bath. And sometimes, when his grandparents came over, he'd say a bad word. Sometimes his mother felt like she'd like to sell him to the zoo. But at nighttime, when that 9-year-old boy was asleep, she would open up the door to his room and crawl across the floor and look up over the side of the bed. And if that 9-year-old was really asleep, she would pick him up and rock him back and forth, back and forth, and back and forth. And as she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. The 9-year-old grew. He grew until he was a teenager. And he wore strange clothes. He listened to strange music. He had strange friends. Sometimes his mother felt like she was living in a zoo. But at nighttime, when that teenager was asleep, she would open up the door to his room, crawl across the floor, and look up over the side of the bed. And if that teenage boy was really asleep, she would pick him up and rock him back and forth, back and forth, and back and forth. And as she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, that teenager grew. He grew until he was a grown-up man. And he moved out of the house and he got a place across town. But sometimes, on dark nights, the mother would get into her car and drive across town. And if all the lights in her son's house were out, she would get out her ladder, climb up the ladder, open up the window, crawl across the floor, and look up over the side of the bed. And if that great big man was really asleep, she would pick him up and rock him back and forth, back and forth. And as she rocked him, she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. Well, that mother grew older. She grew older and older. And one day she called up her son and said, you better come see me because I'm feeling very sick. So the son came to visit her and came to her bedroom, and the mother started to sing the song, and she sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always. But she couldn't finish the song that day because she was feeling too sick. So the son came over and he picked her up and he rocked her back and forth and back and forth, and he sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my mommy you'll be. That son stood for a long time at the top of the stairs in his home. Then he went in to the room where his new baby daughter was sleeping, and he picked her up and he rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and he sang, I'll love you forever, I'll like you for always, as long as I'm living, my baby you'll be. And that's the end of that special story. And I just have a few questions to think about. And one of those questions would be, who are you reminded of in that story? Who was like that mother for you? That person who sings that love song day by day. Could be a person or could be persons. What did that person do in your life that lets you know that they loved you? How did they sing that love song to you in their own way? And another question I have is, how are you living into that story? How are you being like that mother? Who are the people in your life that you sing that love song to day by day? So I just would like to take a moment with you to invite you to think about, you could be thinking about that person that was sang you that love song. You could also be thinking about that person or that persons that you're singing a love song to. Maybe all of them together. And I want to invite us to just take, as it feels comfortable with you, to you, we'll take three deep breaths. Just be still and take three deep breaths and think about those people. Call their name in our hearts and give thanks. Just take it together.
Places I'll remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better, some have gone, and some remain. All these places had their moments with lovers and friends. I still can recall, some are dead and some are living. In my
Thank you, Mary Catherine. The scripture reading for this morning is taken from Luke chapter 2, verses 15 to 21. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. And Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told them. When the eighth day came, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. The word of God.
In the name of our God who creates us, redeems us, sustains us. Amen. A man in his mid-20s suddenly drops the phone and runs 2 miles back to his parents' house. It is a warm mid-morning. A son. We have a son. The year is 1956. The place is Munsieville, a black township on the outskirts of Johannesburg in South Africa. Telephones in Munsieville are few and far between. The one the young man has dropped is at Nurse Bell's house and is the only one for miles around. Here in 1956 South Africa, birth is exclusively a woman's domain. There's no place for a father to wait or to pace at the hospital. And so, controlling his anxiety, young Desmond Tutu has stayed away. The morning after taking his beloved Leah to the hospital, Desmond has made his worried pilgrimage to Nurse Bell's to learn of the progress. But now, the hours of anxious waiting have washed away in a flood of elation and a surge of boundless love. Our blessing, our Thompson, is born. Many years later, I heard and saw the then retired Archbishop Desmond Tutu in Atlanta, Georgia, at the Festival of Homiletics, a 5-day conference full of worship and lectures on preaching. In May 2009, Desmond Tutu was the opening speaker for the conference. So many of us gathered in a huge cathedral just to hear him, to see him, to learn from him. I remember he shared with us the pain and the hurt that had been the result of apartheid in his homeland. And at the same time, his message for all of us was full of forgiveness and God's boundless love. He smiled and laughed like a mischievous, delightful child. In a book published in 2010, Desmond Tutu shares these words about his first day as a father. "Without as much as a glimpse of his face or a whiff of his milky breath, I was in love. In the birth of this child, I experienced something of the life of God. I experienced what it was to love without measure or merit. There was nothing for this child to do to earn my love. With his first breath, he had captured my heart. I loved him because he was. I loved him for being." Whether we are born from the loving union of two people or we are born under other circumstances doesn't matter. Whether our birth parents greeted our arrival with joyful anticipation or with fearful anxiety and regret is of no account. From the time before eternity, our God has awaited each birth with love and delight. In today's gospel passage, a baby is given a name, which is both a promise for the future and an action in the here and now. It's a common name in the scripture of the Jewish people, Yeheshua. It means the Lord saves. The name Jesus that we normally use in Canadian churches has its roots in the Greek of the New Testament, Jesus. Another iteration of it in English is the common name Joshua. So, if you know any Joshuas in your social circle, they have the same moniker as Jesus of Nazareth. I imagine on the eighth day of Jesus' life, when he was circumcised, they read a blessing that was hundreds of years old, even at that time. It comes from the book of Numbers, chapter 6, beginning at verse 24. "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. So shall they put my name on the Israelites, and I will bless them." Do you recognize those words of Scripture? They're also in our hymn book. We often sing the song as a blessing following baptism. I can still recall holding a baby in my arms on a Sunday morning, calling the child by their first, middle, and last, while I sprinkled water on their forehead, "I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. I baptize you in the name of the Triune God." And then the congregation sings, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace." When Jesus of Nazareth was active in his ministry in Galilee, he taught his disciples a prayer. It's a prayer that we say and sing on many Sundays here at Knox. I love the tune that Terry English gave to us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. In the Aramaic language of Jesus' day, the word translated hallowed or holy carries the image of a special place set aside. You can picture a gardener who tills a plot of land and gets rid of all the weeds so that the soil is ready to be planted. Here truly is a special place set aside for new life. Hallowed. Meanwhile, the Aramaic word translated name is not merely a title or a word that we speak so that a person will turn their head and look at us. For a name in the Aramaic carries with it the soul or essence of a person. So when we pray to God, hallowed be your name, we are asking for the very essence of God to live and to flourish within us. And likewise, when we say a person's name, we are speaking to the very soul of that person. Therefore, let us take care with the tone of our voice and the intent of our action when we call another person by their name. In the Gospel of Luke, the birth of the Christ child in the little town of Bethlehem is a hallowed and holy event. For the divine is revealed not in the prideful boasts of the power-hungry, but rather in the faithful, loving bond between a parent and her child. The very essence of God is revealed in tender vulnerability and compassionate love. You and I are invited to join with the shepherds as they hear the news from the angels of the birth of a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this is the sign. And this is the sign. A baby wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. A baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger, a feed trough for animals. And when the shepherds come to the place where the baby is laid, they are filled with wonder. Therefore, they go forth and start to proclaim this amazing news to anyone who has ears to hear. I am grateful for the joyful witness of these shepherds who lived close to the land and who practiced their husbandry with great care. But most of all, I am filled with admiration for the way that Mary created a sacred space for her child to be born. Together with her partner, Joseph, this young woman showed such presence and acceptance. Luke chapter 2, verse 19, and Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. Words from the shepherds about what the angel told them and about how a choir of angels sang the chorus, "Glory to God in the highest, peace, goodwill among the people." How much we need this promise of peace in our world. As we begin 2023, there are so many challenges that we are facing as a human race. We are divided. And so that leads us too often to be mistrustful of the stranger. We can assume that if someone else has joy in their life, that must mean there's less joy available for me. How then shall we live? How then shall we find our way to the place set apart? A holy space where we are safe. The holy moment where each of us is welcomed and called by name. I would like to sing you a song that I wrote many years ago. In that song, I imagine myself as the owner of an inn. And I'm so busy and full of what-ifs of my troubled life that I do not pay attention to a knock on the door of my home. Some strangers have come in a time of great need. A woman's labor is near at hand. And my first thought is, oh no, whatever can I do for this couple? I'm so worried because the inn is full and there's no room. And then comes the wise advice of my married partner and my children. They show me a way forward that is full of kindness, creativity, and hope. A way that makes space for the holy to be born. I wonder how you and I will respond to the good news of this baby's birth. How will the seeds of love planted in the name of God bear good fruit in our souls, the very essence of who we are? A town full of strangers, no room at the inn, when two children heard a knock at their door. They both came a-running, saying, I'll get it first. There was pushing, and they flopped on the floor. But their scowls turned to wide eyes and soft hearts, and they cried out with joy as they smiled. Come on in, please come in, you are welcome to stay. There is always room in our home for two more. There is always room in our home for two more. First they went to find their dad. He was rushing all about, full of worries for his guests. He passed them by. Then they went to their mom. She was making up the beds, but she stopped still. She listened, then she cried. We must find a way to care. There must be a place to share. Father, stop all your rushing and be still. Look who's come our way, and they need a place to stay. There is always room in our home for two more. There is always room in our home for two more. And then the dad says, oh, I don't know what to do for these strangers on this night. For they need a place of quiet that we just cleaned up this morn. There's new hay in the manger, and we can spare some blankets. It's a good place for the baby to be born. So the mom went with the couple as a midwife, and sure enough, the little one was safely born. Then some shepherds came their way. The children knew just what to say. There is always room in our home for three more. There is always room in our home for three more. For we know just what to do for these strangers on this night. Give them love and give them kindness, for the baby has been born. Yes. Our baby has been born. Thank you for your kindness. And let's sing together that bore child of Mary together. Now, hymn number 155 in the Book of Praise.
Leading us in worship today, and your music as well. We have a few announcements. As you can tell, Hugh and Courtney are off today. They're coming back next Sunday and be taking some time to be with their families. I have a few announcements that came out in this week at Knox, just to remind you of. Sunday school will resume again next Sunday, but we just want to remind you that we are still looking for a Sunday school teacher for grades 3 to 5. So if you feel called to do that, please let the office know. There's a number of activities starting up again after the Christmas break. The book study, Saving Us, online is starting on January the 11th at 7:30. You can see the details in your information in your email. If you're not on that email, please let the office know so they can make sure you have that access. Connecting Together is on Monday, January the 16th, coming up. So again, if that's of interest to you, mark it in your calendar. This week at Knox, starting up on January the 18th with Reuben St. James as a speaker, which is great to have him back. And Logos will be starting up on January the 19th. There is an information night for parents on January the 12th, so make note of that for parents and adult participants. We do have a tentative number for our donations as of the end of the year. So I think late last night, an email from Ruth on the total, we received 70% of the goal that we were trying to reach, $148,277. So very close. We are going to give more accurate numbers in the next couple of weeks. We'll have more specific numbers to give you. But we want to thank you for all the ways that you have supported Knox in the past year, 2022, and looking forward to 2023. So we are very grateful for the ways that we have been blessed. God's love shines through the people of our lives. May this offering be a sign of our gratitude that we can express every day of this coming year.
Please be seated. And let's join now together in prayer. O dearest God, inspire us with the image of a mother holding her baby in her arms and rocking her little one gently back and forth. She sings a lullaby, and we are filled with wonder. The holiness of God is truly found in our everyday lives. It is as close to us as the handshake of a friend, the hug of a grandparent, the friendly bark of a dog welcoming you back home. You and I are called by name, treasured and beloved. O gracious Creator, help us to live into this calling that we are children of God. Grant us the courage to speak up on behalf of those who are hurting, alone, and afraid. Inspire us to show deep care for the butterflies and the beavers, the forests and the farmland. And help us to not take the richness of this earth for granted. For God so cherished the world that love came down at Christmas in the birth of a baby who was given the Hebrew name Yeheshua. And God's presence with us, Emmanuel, proclaims a message that whenever a child is born on this planet, a song of glory and joy is proclaimed, of peace on earth, goodwill to all. Source of hope, we offer our supplications for those who are in distress, those who are sick, those who are tired, those who are afraid, those who are hungry, those who do not have a place to call home, those who are facing warfare. We ask that our prayers will give us the courage to be part of your caregiving for our neighbors and for ourselves. And we take a time of quiet to share the prayers of our hearts. Oh, bless your people, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. It is a joy to worship here at Knox. It's a privilege to be able to lead worship with all of you. Let's sing our closing hymn, The Snow Lay on the Ground. I love this hymn. We'll sing it together.
Was born on Christmas night beneath the
What a wonder. What a wonderful wonder that God came to be with us as a baby, much adored by his parents, Mary and Joseph. God called Joseph, called Jesus beloved, so that we may know that all of us are cherished. Truly, each one of us is special, just the way we are. Amen.
I'm Hugh Donnelly, one of the ministers at Knox, Waterloo. Thank you for being a part of the worshiping community today. You can find us online at knoxwaterloo.ca, and you are always welcome to call us at 519-886-4150. This broadcast is made possible by you, listeners and friends of Knox, who support Knox's broadcast ministry. Please consider making a donation in gratitude as you are able, and may the peace of Christ be with you.